Okay, welcome back to lesson two. And today we're going to be talking about what made Jesus so unexpected. What was it about him that surprised people? And I hope that you have enjoyed this week's reading and that you're learning what God is like by reading the story of Jesus and learning from his life. I want to recap a little bit what we've learned so far. We've talked to the first week about how Mark's goal was to share good news with us. And the word that he chose, evangelion, was used typically to bring news about a new king or to celebrate a military victory that this new king or another military leader had brought for the people. So that was the word that he chose to describe what Jesus was doing in his life. Jesus came to show us what God is like, and Jesus came to heal our greater need. And that's what we spent some time talking about last week. And our greatest need is for forgiveness. We ended by talking a little bit about repentance and how repentance is agreeing with God and being honest about our brokenness and our need to be fixed by him, and also trusting in the fact that God made a way and provided a solution by sending Jesus on our behalf to achieve that victory. But it's important to also note that Jesus and God did this in very unexpected ways, in ways that the people were not necessarily ready or prepared for. So that's what we're going to talk about today. Okay, we're going to start with Mark 2:17. And this is a quote by Jesus. It's one of my favorites. He says, "It's not the healthy who need a doctor, but the sick. I have not come to call the righteous, but sinners." And we're going to look at this quote in context in a little bit, but I want to start there and say that Jesus spent time with unexpected people. So he does unexpected things, and he hangs out with unexpected people. And that's really what we're going to look at today. So Jesus ate dinner with sinners. This is my summary of this story, and I love this because it's a little catchy. Jesus ate dinner with sinners. He spent time with sinners and even invited them to be his disciples. Tax collectors and sinners followed Jesus, and he ate dinner with them. So Jesus sought out to spend time with unexpected people who were known to be sinners. The teachers of the law were surprised because they personally put a lot of effort into avoiding tax collectors and sinners. So again, we see this contrast between Jesus and the teachers of the law, which is something Mark loves to do. And the idea is that Jesus sought out these people that the teachers of the law spent most of their lives trying to avoid. So listen for that as we get into this story. And I want us to see from this story who Jesus loves. And it's surprising. It's unexpected. So we'll start with Mark 2:13-17. "Once again, Jesus went out beside the lake. A large crowd came to him, and he began to teach them. As he walked along, he saw Levi, son of Alphaeus, sitting at the tax collector's booth. 'Follow me,' Jesus told him, and Levi got up and followed him." So we hear this story and we're like, Jesus is out for a walk. He sees a man and says, "Follow me." That's how we tend to hear this story. But people at the time would have heard this and would have been immediately shocked by something we may not see right off the bat. Jesus called Levi to follow him. And Levi was a tax collector. And maybe you've heard this before, but I think it always bears repeating who the tax collectors would have been in this society and in this community and how they would have been viewed. So Levi's profession, his job, was to collect taxes from his fellow Jews to give to the Roman Empire. And so the Roman Empire at the time had controlled the land of Israel. They were in charge of it in sort of an oppressive way. They made laws that were difficult for Jews to live under. And the way that they funded their empire was collecting money from the lands that they had conquested. So Levi's job was to go out and collect money from his fellow Jews and to give it to their hated enemies. So I want you to see that. And the way that Levi made his own income was by padding the amount of money he asked his fellow Jews to give. So I just want you to picture that. He's your neighbor, and he comes to you and asks you for money to give to people that are your enemies, and he makes his own income. And by the way, he has a really nice house and some great stuff that he seems to be doing well for himself, and the way that he's doing that is by charging you extra. So he's not a popular person. He doesn't get invited to dinner parties, but that is who Jesus calls to follow him. So let's go on with the story. While Jesus was having dinner at Levi's house, many tax collectors and sinners were eating with him and his disciples, for there were many who followed him. When the teachers of the law, who were Pharisees, saw him eating with the sinners and tax collectors, they asked his disciples, "Why does he eat with tax collectors and sinners?" So Jesus had dinner with sinners, and I want us to see here that having dinner with somebody wasn't like, let's go grab a Coke, you know, from Chipotle. It was, they went into their house, they spent time with them, and when you did that, you were endorsing them as human beings. You were endorsing their families. You were basically saying, this is my dear friend whom I love. I'm spending time in their home because they're important and they're valuable to me, and I approve of everything they do. So the fact that Jesus went to Levi's house to have a meal with this sort of social understanding was a pretty shocking idea, and the teachers of the law are completely horrified by this. They don't approve of this. And I was trying really hard to think of a modern equivalent, and this might sound a little shocking, but I kind of think this is how they would have heard this. It's essentially like Jesus went over to a drug dealer's house and invited all of the other drug dealers and prostitutes to have dinner with him. That's sort of how they felt about this. Why on earth are you associating with this person? And not just this person, but all of his friends who are just like him. Why are you going to his house and sharing a meal and saying that you approve of him and that you love him? And that is exactly what Jesus is doing. It's unexpected. It's a little bit shocking. Jesus did unexpected things, and he was not the Messiah the people expected. But let's finish up with the story. Mark 2, 13 through 17. On hearing this, Jesus said to them, "It's not the healthy who need a doctor, but the sick. I have not come to call the righteous, but sinners." So Jesus is doing unexpected things in unexpected ways in order to teach us something about the heart of God. So let's not forget that Jesus' job, or what he's doing, is to show us who God is and what God is like. So Jesus came to find broken people who knew that they were broken. The religious leaders needed healing too, but they didn't know it yet, or they didn't believe it. So Jesus went to the people who knew they were broken, who were honest about that, and were honest with God about that, and were willing to listen to Jesus and to love Jesus and to hear what he had to say. And because of that, they could be made whole. And the religious leaders were standing outside questioning that, challenging that, and not being okay with that because they were a little bit in denial about their own need. So again, there's that contrast between Jesus going after broken people who were following him like crazy and wanting to learn from him, and the religious leaders who were like, wait a minute, that's not okay, because they can't get over themselves enough to see their own need. So Mark loves those contrasts, and he's putting one on display for us here. But I want us to see ourselves in this story. And it's hard sometimes because we want to say, well, I'm not a drug dealer or a prostitute. But God is saying all of us are broken. We all have this greatest need. And that is the need that Jesus came to address. And the question is, are we willing to be honest with God and repent of those things and allow him to heal what's broken in our lives? And we can only do that by starting from a frame of honesty. So what more sort of Messiah was Jesus? If he's not the expected Messiah, if he's unexpected, what sort of Messiah is he? So the people expected the Messiah to be a political or military leader like King David. Remember, we talked about the images that they would have had in their head of a Messiah would be a deliverer like Moses, who is going to lead them out of the oppression of the Roman Empire, or a warrior like King David who's going to defeat all of their enemies and then create this golden age of wealth and prosperity and peace. So those are the things that they're expecting. But Jesus is not that. He was not that sort of a Messiah. He didn't meet their expectations. And this is going to come up again and again in this story as we read through the Gospel of Mark. And I think it's important to slow down and to say, Jesus obeyed God, right? That was his interest, was obeying God and God's plan, not meeting our expectations. And that's a hard thing for us to hear sometimes, but I think it's important. There's a lesson in this for us. God does not operate according to our expectations. He's not a puppet. He's not some cosmic Santa Claus that grants our wishes when we ask them and is at our beck and call. God is God. And if that's true, he sets the rules, right? And he is coming to bring wholeness and forgiveness, but he's doing it on his own terms. It's not to be this warrior or this political leader who's going to make all the disciples, you know, his top people in this new kingdom. It's to show us a way of brokenness in the sense of entering into suffering and service. And those are not what the people expected. They expected a leader to ride in on a horse and defeat everybody. And he's showing that he's a different kind of Messiah that comes alongside and travels with people and eats in their homes and heals their sick and teaches them and provides food for them. He does just different and unusual and surprising things. And then he will go on to suffer at the hands of their enemies and die on a cross. And you've got to think that the disciples all along the way are saying, wait a minute, is this how it's supposed to be? I'm confused. I was expecting something completely different. So what I want us to see is that Jesus is unexpected. And the people during this time period were a little bit mystified about what was going on. You'll notice in the Gospel of Mark that the disciples are constantly confused. Like, what's going on? What is he saying? What are we doing now? They're just not sure of what Jesus is doing, but they're there and they're following because, like we saw last week, they were amazed because they'd never seen anything like this before. They've never heard someone teach with such authority. And I want you to see that about Jesus. He's confusing. He's unexpected. And in some ways, the disciples are struggling with their own emotions about that, but they're still following. They're still there because no one is like Jesus. And that's compelling to them, and they're going to see it through. And God meets them in that. Okay, so what does all of us teach us about God? Jesus called sinners to follow him and to be his disciples. So not only did Jesus have dinner at Levi's house, Levi became one of Jesus' disciples. Later on, his name is changed to Matthew, and he is actually the author of Matthew's gospel. So tax collector turned disciple turned gospel writer. God is pursuing sinners. That's what we see. That's what we're learning from the life of Jesus. Jesus is an unexpected Messiah. He does things that we don't expect. And sometimes that's hard for us to deal with because we have our own expectations. Jesus came to call sinners, not people who already thought they were righteous. He wants us to be honest about our brokenness. And that's where he can begin to heal. But it starts with honesty. Okay. He did not come to rule as a king or to conquer as a military leader. He came to pursue the broken, to serve the needy, and to die in order to fix our greatest need. This was unexpected news, but this was also really good news. I hope you're beginning to see that Jesus makes unexpected good news for us. So let me pray, and you all can go and discuss this in your groups. Lord Jesus, I thank you that you do the unexpected, and I thank you that you were willing to be obedient to God, and you place that as a higher priority than in meeting our expectations, because our expectations are too low. And God, I pray that you would just bring us to the point of willingness to be honest with you about our brokenness. Help us to see that that's where healing begins, as we trust in you to meet our greatest need. In your name I pray. Amen.